Whoa, free boat ride for three. Now, who should I take?
I'm on a boat, I'm on a boat. Everybody look at me, cause I'm sailing on a boat.
Yeah, never thought I'd be on a boat. It's a big blue watery road. Yeah, Poseidon, look at me. Never thought I'd see the day when a big boat coming my way.
All right, so I want to call your attention to a small portion of scripture in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 14, beginning at verse number 28. Matthew 14, verse 28, Peter says, "Lord, if it's you, tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on water, and came toward Jesus. I want to end the reading of God's word there, and I want to talk from this subject in our time together. It's two words. I believe it's the Holy Spirit's encouragement to us tonight. It is abandon ship. It's been said and suggested that the actions of God are always intentional. In other words, God does not operate randomly, flippantly, or haphazardly. Rather, God is deliberate, intentional, strategic, so that his actions are never an end unto themselves. They are always a means to an end. Whenever God does something you do see, God is doing something else you don't see. He's intentional. So when he does something, he's doing something because he's intentional. And when he does nothing, he's doing something because he's intentional. Because when he does something, he's doing something intentionally. And when he does nothing, he's doing nothing intentionally. So when he's doing something, he's doing something. And when he's doing nothing, he's doing something. This is why we should be consistent and enthusiastic with our praise, because praise is appropriate when he's doing something, because he's doing something. But then praise is also appropriate when he's doing nothing, because when he's doing nothing, he's doing something. And I know we've mastered the art of praising him when he does something. I want to know, is there anyone in the room tonight that's willing to praise him when it seems like he's doing nothing, because he's doing nothing intentionally? And one of the things God seems to be intentional about in scripture is this consistent communication to his followers regarding how he sees them. He seems to go to great lengths to use a number of different words to describe to the believer who they are from a divine vantage point. And if God is intentional, we need to ask why. And I believe Solomon captures this in Proverbs when he says, "As a man thinks in his heart, so is he." In other words, we will always behave in a way that is consistent with the way we see ourselves. Therefore, in order for God to change our behavior, he's got to get us to see us the way he sees us. So we begin to behave in a way that's consistent with the way he sees us and not the way we see ourselves. And out of all of the words God uses to describe the believer, normal is not one of them. Words like salt, light, chosen, called, elected, selected, anointed, beloved, special, peculiar, are all terms the scriptures use to depict our difference, because God's trying to get us to see to be different is to be normal for the Christian. And this truth can be captured in this passage I just read here in the book of Matthew. Postured in this passage here in Matthew is a principle I've affectionately entitled the principle of exception. And this principle can be captured in the following phrase: what happens with them does not dictate and determine what happens with me. This suggests that previous patterns are not accurate indicators of future possibilities. That you cannot look at what happened with someone else, my age, my type, my gender, my race, and use what happened with them as a marker and a measuring tool to predict what can happen with me. Because what happens with them does not dictate and determine what happens with me. This is not a declaration of superiority. This is a declaration of distinction. We're not saying we're better than. We're saying we're different from. And this difference is not in the experience. The difference is in the outcome. We may go through some of the same things other people go through, but we don't come out the same way other people come out, because God is the God of exceptions. And the scriptures are inundated with examples of this truth. Men don't go in lions' dens and come out in one piece. But with Daniel, God made an exception. Boys don't go into fiery furnaces and then come out and not even smell like smoke. But with the Hebrew boys, God made an exception. Walls don't fall by people screaming at them. But with Joshua, God made an exception. Women in their 90s don't have babies. But with Sarah, God made an exception to show you that no matter what season of life you're in, you can still give birth to what God put on the inside of you. Red seas do not part on their own, but with Moses, God made an exception. And dead men don't go in a grave, stay there 3 days, and then get up Sunday morning. But with Jesus, God made an exception. And if God did it for Daniel, if he did it for Joshua, if he did it for the Hebrew boys, if he did it for Moses, if he did it for Sarah, if he did it for Jesus, I came to tell you tonight, he's getting ready to do it for you. Because God is the God of exceptions. Yeah, just because it hadn't been done doesn't mean it can't be done. Yeah, just because it didn't happen for them doesn't mean it can't happen for you. I don't need it to happen for everybody. I need it to happen for me. And I don't know who this is for tonight, but you have been misgauging who you should look at to determine what God wants to do in your life. You're trying to find who else has done it to determine whether or not you can do it, and you don't know you're looking for yourself. Because when you can't find the person that's already done it, it's because God wants to use you to be the one to go first. I speak this over somebody's life in this house tonight. You are looking for an example, but God is calling you to be the example. You got the anointing of first on you. Somebody shout one time and make the devil mad. Don't tell me what I can't do. You can't do it. You can't find what you're looking for because you're looking for you. You, John the Baptist, you preparing the way. You're looking for a prepared way, but you're preparing the way. Because what happens with them does not dictate and determine what can happen with me. This is interesting because there's a word I want to use to describe people who embrace this principle of exception. Notice I didn't say understand this principle of exception, because it's possible to cognitively believe something is possible, but not believe it's possible for you. So we got to make sure in church we don't confuse understanding a concept with believing it. You can understand healing and not believe it. Just because it's written in my notes doesn't mean it's written on my heart. And so there's a word I want to use to describe those who embrace this principle of exception, and the word I want to use is water walker. John Ortberg notes that it's not abnormal to see walking in the Bible, is it right? The Bible says God walked in the garden in the cool of the day. Joshua walked around the walls of Jericho. Enoch walked with God. Moses walked through the Red Sea. The disciples walked on the Emmaus Road. Jesus walked the Via Dolorosa. Walking is not exceptional when it takes place on land. But in the text, we see something different. We see people walking on what other people drown in. We see an exception, and it's interesting because we picked up the story in verses 28 and 29, but the narrative really begins in verse 22. It's interesting because verse 22 begins with the word immediately, and it's referring to right after Jesus performs the miracle with the two fish and five loaves of bread, right? Immediately, the disciples had witnessed the miracle. Now they're getting ready to participate in one. So they learn by instruction. Now they're getting ready to learn by experience, because those are the two ways God teaches you, right? You learn through instruction in church. You learn by experience in life. And this is what happens. The Bible says immediately after this miracle, Jesus makes them leave. It's teaching us, I believe, something about the nature of miracles. And that is, the impact of miracles is not seen just in the miracle itself, but in the message the miracle sends. So if you receive the miracle but miss the message, you're robbing yourself of the value of what God has done. You see, when Jesus performed the miracle with the two fish and five loaves, check this out. After a while, they will be hungry again. So the power of the miracle is not in the miracle itself, but in the message the miracle gives. It's one thing to experience God's provision. That's the miracle. It's another thing to get the message that God is a provider. So this is dope, because Jesus puts them in a boat. This is interesting. He puts them in a boat, and he sends them ahead to go ahead of him to the other side while he dismisses the crowd and then goes off to a solitary place to pray. So they're rowing with this sense of divine absence, and they're in this boat going to the other side, and they run into a storm. The only reason they run into a storm is because Jesus put them in the boat and sent them to the other side. Don't miss this. When we talk about storms in the Bible, very often we focus on the storms you run into because you didn't do what God said. But right here in the book of Matthew, we see something different. We see people running into a storm because they did do what God said. And I bet when they ran into the storm, that storm on the sea caused them to question what they felt like they heard on the shore. Before they left, they probably Instagramming, God sending me to the other side. Hashtag, it's my season. Hashtag, you can't stop me now. Hashtag, favor God's on my side. They DMing people and tweeting and messaging people, but then they probably get in the middle of the storm, and the storm is probably causing them to question what they heard on the shore. God, now did you really tell me to leave the shore? Not realizing that sometimes the storm is not an indication of satanic activity. Sometimes the storm is confirmation of divine activity. It is God's way of letting you know that you are headed in the right direction, and the devil is afraid of you making it to the other side. Did you hear what I just said? So some of you are scared in storms, not realizing the only reason you're in a storm is because the devil is scared, and he does not want you to get to the other side, and he's trying to use the storm to intimidate you to the degree that you turn around. It's interesting because the Bible says Jesus sends the disciples ahead of him. So they're in the middle of the lake ahead of him. And the Bible says Jesus prays until about dawn. And then he walks out right before dawn, meeting them in the middle of the sea. They had a head start, the equivalent of hours. But in the middle of the sea, Jesus caught up. They were rowing, Jesus was praying. They were stressing, Jesus was praying. They were sweating, Jesus was praying. And in the middle of the sea, Jesus walks to where they rowed to. They started before him, but they didn't finish before him. This is a message to us. Just because someone seems to be ahead of you in this season, just because they are starting before you, doesn't mean they will finish before you. Because sometimes people are wondering why it seems as if God seems to have me in a holding pattern, and other people are progressing in ways that I desire to progress in my own life, not realizing and recognizing that Jesus spent time building into himself the spiritual stamina that he needed so that when he walked on water, he wouldn't sink. You missed it. Because Peter tried to do what Jesus did in public without doing what Jesus did in private. Some people are getting there before you, but they won't stay because they have not built into themselves the spiritual stamina that they need. Might I tell you, God is taking longer with you because when God gets you there, he wants to make sure you stay there. You will step and you will not sink. When God builds that spiritual stamina into you, it helps deal with the backside of the blessing. To whomsoever much is given, much is required, right? Yeah, there's a front side of the blessing. That's what we do see. Then there's a backside of the blessing. That's what we don't see. And sometimes we feel like we're in delay and that certain things should be happening faster because we're just looking at the front side of the blessing. And God's like, you're ready for the front side of the blessing, but you're not quite ready for the backside of the blessing, right? Because the promotion is the front side. The pressure is the backside. The elevation is the front side. The hating is the backside. And God says, I need to make sure you are equipped and prepared to handle not just the front, but the back. But I speak to somebody in this place today who's dealing with anxiety because you feel like you're behind schedule. You feel like you're too old. You feel like it should have happened by now. I came to tell you they rolled their way there, but God's getting ready to help you walk your way there. Did you hear what I just said? Because the scriptures teach he restores the years. That doesn't mean God gives you more time. It means he redeems time. It means he'll take the time you got left and he'll do more in the time you got left than he did in the time you wasted. I'm speaking to somebody tonight. God can open one door this year that will make up for 10 doors that you missed because he's the God that redeems time. I want somebody to prophesy to your future and say, I'm on my way. Jesus, check this out, comes walking, right, on the sea. And the Bible says, the disciples say, it's a ghost. Don't miss this. I got a question. If you've been walking with Jesus, eating with Jesus, traveling with Jesus for 3 years, how do you not know what he looks like? Maybe it's because God doesn't always show up looking like God in a storm. Could it be that they mislabeled what they saw because they labeled it prematurely? They called it a ghost in one season, but then they called them God later. And when you label certain things in your storm prematurely, you may have to come back and relabel it later because there are some things you might be calling one thing now, but this time next year, you're gonna be calling it God. You might call it a breakup now, but this time next year, you're gonna look back and say, that was God. Ooh, that was God. You might call it betrayal now, but you're gonna look back and say, that was God. You're calling it a layoff, but you're gonna look back and say, that was God. You're calling it heartbreak, you're gonna look back and say, that was God. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but I want you to know you're mislabeling your storm. This isn't a ghost, it's God. Listen to this. So Peter says, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come to you on the water. This is interesting to me, because Peter's a fisherman by trade. He's accustomed to the water, but I don't think he's ever made a request like this. And he didn't make a request like this because he hadn't been exposed to anyone who's done it. But once God exposed him, that exposure awakened in him an appetite that now made a comfortable thing, the boat, uncomfortable. The boat wasn't uncomfortable until he saw somebody walking on water. God allowed him to see it, to be exposed to it, because God knows once you've been exposed, you can't be unexposed. That exposure created an appetite for more. That exposure created a frustration with a thing God didn't want him to stay in, because God uses frustration as an indication that you no longer belong on the level you're at. Frustration is fuel. Frustration is on God's payroll. God uses frustration to keep us from being comfortable in places where we have outstayed our season. And I want to say, I'm glad some of you are frustrated. I'm glad some of you are irritated. I'm glad some of you have some holy discontent, because maybe that is God's way of using frustration to get you to step out of something you should no longer be sitting in. So Peter says, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come. Jesus said, come. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on water, and came toward Jesus. Some people can't walk on water because come is not enough. He didn't say come and take three steps. He didn't say come and I'm going to make the water like a roadway. He didn't say come and the wind's going to blow and you're going to lose focus. All he said was come, because water walkers are willing to go. They realize that God gives incremental instruction, but he doesn't give incomplete instruction. And that he gives information on a need-to-know basis. Because we don't walk by sight, we walk by faith. And as we take steps, God gives revelation. And as we take steps, God gives revelation. And the more you step, the more he'll show. The more you step, the more he'll show. Because water walkers are willing to go on a come. I said all that just to say this. Jesus didn't say, come, Peter. Jesus just said, come. And Peter had enough sense and faith to say, well, if you say come, I don't know what y'all doing. I'm getting ready to abandon ship. I don't know who this is for, but I believe God is speaking a word in victory, and the word is come. And whoever has the faith to take personal possession of God's promises. I want to show you something. It wasn't unbelievers in the boat. It was disciples in the boat. So Peter didn't distinguish himself from the world. He distinguished himself from believers. God called him out of the boat a normal Christianity. He had to be willing to deal with all the questions that come when you're the only one on the water. He had to feel weird on the water. He's the only one out there but Jesus. Probably wrestling, am I overly ambitious? Have I missed it? Am I wired wrong? Am I too optimistic? Because nobody else is out here. Yes, there is. Because Peter never asked to walk on water, read the text. He asked to come to Jesus. Tell me to come to you on the water. And I came tonight for the weird. I did. I came for the awkward. I came for those who aren't built for the boat. But you keep staying there because that's where James and John and Thomas are. You keep staying there because you're waiting on somebody else to get out first. And God's waiting on you. And so here's my question. What is it for real, that's keeping you in the boat though? It might be approval addiction. It might be that you want the approval of the 11, but difference makers are different. And you're waiting on you. So today I'm going to pray that God, I believe he works miracles in our body, but I also believe he works miracles in our heart. When it comes to a person's spiritual quality of life, that's the most consequential miracle you can ever get. Jesus said, I came to heal the brokenhearted. And I'm going to pray that whatever's going on in that heart that's keeping you in that boat, that God would expose it and address it, because you don't belong there. You're not built for it. You're not called to it. And I'm telling you right now, you're going to die on that boat. That boat is not as safe as you think it is. That spiritually you're going to die. Your dreams are going to die. Your vision's going to die. Your joy is going to die. Your fulfillment is going to die. Would you lift your hands all over this room? So, Father, tonight, we hear your summons, you calling us out of conformity and normalcy, you calling us to embrace our uniqueness and our awkwardness. We aren't built for the boat, and we're dying there. So I pray in Jesus' name right now, for the uprooting of strongholds and rejection issues and passive aggressiveness and approval addiction and the need and the disease to please. Father, we don't have 5 years to work this out through therapy. We need supernatural intervention. Destiny is calling, purpose is near, doors are swinging open. So I pray right now that the heart healer will begin to heal hearts all over this room. Oof, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would go to the cracks and the crevices. And you begin to fill those cracks with your love and your affirmation. And I thank you that even now, chains are breaking, yokes being destroyed, burdens lifting, fire falling, fresh fire, consuming fire, fall in this place in the name of Jesus. Burn away every chain and fetter. Fill us again with your spirit. Set the captive free. And we will not settle for normalcy or standardization. We hear you calling and we come. No normal marriages, no normal businesses, no normal churches, no normal minds, no normal money, no normal ministry, no normal leadership. I don't want normal. I want God. I don't want normal. I want God. I don't want ordinary. I want extraordinary. I don't want the boat. I want the water. I am a water walker. Let me hear the water walkers shout in this house. Father, thank you for what you have done tonight. We know the devourer comes to steal the seed of your word, and so I pray that you would surround our heart with a hedge, that this word would bring forth fruit that remains. And we declare that we are not only out of the boat, we will stay out. That we were not built for Saul's armor. We will use our slingshot and we will slay our Goliath our way. And may it be said of us as it was said of the early church, these are they that have turned the world upside down. In Jesus' name, amen. Give him praise if you got any left.